high-quality protein that's 10 times cheaper than beef, industrial cattle ranching bankrupt in just 10 years, acreage almost the size of the Louisiana Purchase returned to its natural state where it can store massive amounts of atmospheric carbon. That impossible Whopper you're holding, it's just the beginning of a major disruption to our food system. Just wait till you see what's coming next. I'm Vince Werner, and this is the Flexitarian Times. We have a lot to cover here, so let's get started. Precision fermentation. Remember that phrase. It's going to matter in your life in a big way. If we play our cards right, it might just save the planet, bring about world peace and global hunger, solve the climate crisis, and maybe even make you a lot of money if you invest well. So I figure it's worth remembering. According to independent think tank RethinkX, precision fermentation is the emerging technology that's going to make this future possible. As a matter of fact, we're already using it, but you just may not know it. More on that in a minute. But just what is precision fermentation? Kind of sounds like brewing beer. Well, that's because it is a lot like brewing beer. A vat full of microbes are put to work turning things we have, like plants, into things we want, like alcohol. Only in the case of precision fermentation, we're able to custom design these microbes, fine-tuning them to crank out pretty much any organic molecule you can think of. Molecules like the proteins and fats and collagen that we currently get from meat or milk. We've actually been using precision fermentation bioreactors for about 10,000 years. What they do is they break down the nutrients found in grass and grain and turn them into essential proteins and fats that our bodies use for fuel. We call these precision fermentation bioreactors animals. Even though the nutrient conversion efficiency is just 4%, it was the only game in town. I mean, it's not like there wasn't plenty of land available to let the animals graze. So this system worked out great for us for a long time. But over the last few decades, we've been running into limits on just how many of these animal bioreactors we can put into service. Feeding a couple hundred million of us on the planet is one thing, but as our global population heads toward 9 billion people, that 4% efficiency just ain't cutting it anymore. This here is how much land we devote to raising animals for food in the US. This includes the land needed to grow the food for our food. As I said, it's crazy inefficient. And the US is only a small percentage of the people on this planet. We're cutting down forests at an alarming rate just to create more land to grow the food to feed the animals that we turn into our food. Even the CEO of Tyson agrees that isn't sustainable. So some really smart people have started looking for ways to cut out the middleman, turning plants into meat without using an animal in the middle to do all the work. First out of the gate are plant-based alternatives to processed meat products. Companies like Beyond Meat, Impossible Foods, and many others are asking the question, just what are the qualities and attributes that make a burger, or a chicken nugget? Then they find plant-based ingredients and processes to best mimic the look, mouthfeel, and taste of a real burger or chicken nugget or what have you. I think they do a pretty good job, and they're getting better all the time. Actually, Impossible Foods already uses precision fermentation to make the ingredient heme, which is an iron-rich chemical normally found in blood. It makes their plant-based burger bleed and gives it that meaty flavor and aroma when it's seared. Today, we can scarf down our favorite comfort foods while making a much smaller impact on the planet, our health, and of course, on animals. That is, if we're willing to pay a little bit more. Although that's changing too. We've also been hearing a lot about another strategy to bypass the cow, cell-based meat. Sometimes it's also called cultured meat or clean meat or test tube meat or Franken meat, among other things. Basically, this involves taking tissue cells from live animals and growing them into commercial quantities of muscle and fat. It is literally animal meat. It's just that it's made without using an animal, other than the harmless harvest of cells from the donor animal. It's early days, but this segment is attracting a lot of capital investment. It's been done, and it works. But it does have a ways to go before approaching the costs and capacity required to bankrupt the livestock industry in 10 years or so. Part of the reason? Cost. The growth factors, the broth if you will, that supports the replication of the animal cells is very expensive. But guess how we can create the proteins needed for those growth factors in infinite quantity and at a very low cost? You got it. Precision fermentation. Modern foods based on precision fermentation, or PF, will be cheap, can be made basically anywhere, and can contain the exact taste, texture, and nutritional attributes desired. According to the RethinkX report, we're talking 10 times more efficient at converting feedstock into end products, using 10 times less water, 5 times less energy, and 100 times less land. This doesn't even take into account that precision fermentation can happen anywhere, meaning it's less centralized, cutting down on shipping costs and even disputes over land and water rights. At the rate things are going, foods made this way will reach price parity with animal products in just like 3 to 5 years. And during the 2030s, we'll see these prices drop to a tenth the cost of animal products. And because the feedstock is ubiquitous and the manufacturing is distributed and highly automated, these modern foods will be incredibly resilient to things like weather events and, oh, I don't know, pandemics? According to the report, the superior quality, flexibility, and price of precision fermentation proteins will have industrial agriculture circling the drain by the end of this decade. I know, it sounds crazy, but we actually do have some precedent to support this prognosis. Here's a couple of examples. First, consider insulin. Until relatively recent times, diabetics relied on insulin derived from the pancreases of cows and pigs. Lots of them. 50,000 animals were required to produce 1 kilogram of insulin. The extracted insulin then underwent a great deal of processing, which still allowed for impurities and inconsistent quality. There were issues with allergic reactions and potential shortages. In the 1970s, it was projected that 56 million animals would be needed to address the growing epidemic of diabetes in the United States. Then, in 1982, the FDA approved Humulin, an insulin created using genetically modified yeast. That's right, precision fermentation. Humulin managed sugar levels better, with fewer side effects and more consistent quality, although initially it was pretty pricey. But by the year 2000, animal insulin had only 1% of the market left. Then there's the case of cheese. If you know anything about cheese making, you've probably heard of rennet. It's a group of enzymes that serve to separate the curds from the liquid of the milk. More or less forever, rennet was taken from the stomachs of calves. They secrete it so that they can digest their mother's milk. Their bodies quit making it after about 60 days. Well, when animal rights concerns caused a downturn in the market for veal in the 70s, that caused the price of rennet to skyrocket. Eventually, precision fermentation came to the rescue. A method to produce pure chymosin was developed. That's the active ingredient in rennet. Besides being much more efficient and humane than the old way of getting it, it worked better. In 1990, the FDA approved fermentation-produced chymosin, or FPC, for use in food. And by 2012, it was used to make more than 90% of the cheese produced in the United States. So as you can see, when something comes along that is better, cheaper, and orders of magnitude more efficient to make, disruption almost inevitably follows. Things that nobody saw coming can happen really fast. And that's why RethinkX believes that we are on the precipice of what they call the second domestication of plants and animals, the greatest disruption in how our species feeds itself since we transitioned from hunter-gatherers to farmers and renters about 10,000 years ago. And this, the 2020s, is a decade where most of it's going to take place. This is huge. In a disruption of this scale, there will be big winners and big losers. This changes literally everything about life on planet Earth. So I just thought you'd want to know. But is all this really going to happen? Well, it is the future we're talking about here, so... Oh. But there is a pretty compelling case being made by some people with a pretty good track record. Check it out for yourself. You can download the entire report for free at the link I've placed in the description. Let me know what you think by leaving a comment. And if you found this video at all interesting, I'd really appreciate it if you'd like and share it so that I can do more of them. When it comes to the topic of finding better ways to feed ourselves, there is a lot to talk about. So until next time, this is the Flexitarian Times. I'm Vince, and thanks for watching.